people love you, Lord.
Good morning. Good morning. All right, I'm not here alone. Amen. We want to do a special welcome for anyone who's visiting here with us for the very first time, and also for any woman who is here who has ever mothered anyone. Happy Mother's Day. Since today is Mother's Day, it is time for the Care and Up baby bottle collection. You will notice out in the foyer that there is a basket of baby bottles. What we would ask is that you might take a bottle, put your loose change in there, although I know they will accept a check if you want to write a check and slip it in the bottle. And on Father's Day, we will collect the bottles and they will go to the CareNet Pregnancy Support Center to help them out, to help support their budget. Jim has an announcement about the softball.
Yes, I'm up here to talk about the shirts. First of all, our practice, there's sunglasses left on the field, so if anyone forgot their glasses, come see me. Hopefully Heather's eyes are okay. These shirts here, let me see. This is the actual shirt that we're going to be ordering. It's a poly double mesh, and... Okay. It's going to be a royal blue like this. They didn't have one, but it's with the white lettering across. It's going to be say Grace Fellowship in cursive, and we're going to have a Bible referenced verse there. The important part of this is I'd like to order them this week. The team knows about it, but anyone who would else like to order a shirt, I need to know really today. So I'll be out in the foyer and sign you up and let me know. Or the cost of the shirt would be $20, so I'll let you know that. And also what size. So I need to know this week. Okay, and I think that's it. Oh, first game is Monday at Dow Field. Pat did a great job looking at your bulletin. There's a nice schedule there and field directions. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Chad and Judy have an announcement. Coming at me from both directions.
Okay, so next Sunday after the service, we got quite a bit going on. The first thing is concerning the polling team, so I'll hand it over to Judy to announce that.
Next Sunday, directly after the service, everybody go into the fellowship hall and join us for a delicious meal. We're supporting the Poland team. The meal is free. Just come to the meal. Please do sign up, though, in the foyer. There's a sign up. It says whether you're coming or not. And if you forget to sign up, just show up anyway. But we get an idea of how much food we need to make. Also is the pie contest. And we know that you bake pie. So please bake a pie for the pie contest if you can. If you forget to sign up, again, just bring the pie. And you'll be able to hear more about how that helps out the missions team going to Poland next week. Also, the tag sale is May 30th, which sounds like it's really far away and it's only a couple of weeks. So if you can start bringing in things for the tag sale, anything that you have that's in good working condition, and bring it and just put it in the fellowship hall, maybe put a note on it and just let it know that that's what it's for. Thank you.
Okay, so then after the luncheon, which I'd encourage you all to go to and support the team, after that we're going to have an important youth ministry meeting upstairs, and that's going to be for people who are interested in getting involved next year. I'm going to spend the first about 10-15 minutes kind of laying out the vision for next year and showing different ways that you can get involved. We definitely have a lot of great kids coming up into our program, and we want to have a lot of volunteers to be able to facilitate that, develop relationships with the kids so we can do a lot more things. After that, we're going to be doing Alpha Training, which is a program that we're going to start using next year that is a pretty tried and true program that should help our kids just have a really good base knowledge of the scriptures that they can build off of as they, you know, seek to be more Christ-like and develop more relationships with Christ and the church. So please come to that. If you're just interested, you could just come for the first 10, 15 minutes, figure out a way you can get involved, and then leave after that. But it'll be a good thing after church. You get lunch. You don't have to worry about doing lunch plans. You can support the polling team, and then you can learn a little bit more about the youth ministry. So I'd encourage you all to do that. Thank you.
Thank you both. Okay, please also take some time to look through your bulletin. There are additional ways to help support the Poland Missions team. That information is in there as well as another of other announcements that we don't quite have time to go through everything on. I am going to ask that we start thinking about doing the Grace Chapel, the Grace Fellowship Shuffle, I think I was told it's called. What it means is, as we are growing by the grace of God, we'd like to kind of move in and close up any empty seats around you. So when folks come in a little bit late, they're not like hunting and climbing over people to find a seat. So please keep that in mind as we go forward. And we have a special Mother's Day video with a little levity. We hope you all enjoy it. Oh no, what's wrong?
Did she break up with you?
What? No, no. It's just, Dad's getting rid of Charlie.
I'm sorry. Do you mind?
What?
How dare you?
What?
Thanks. Hey, Mom?
Yeah.
Can we just keep this between you and me?
You got it.
Thanks.
Hey, my thought for this morning before the call to worship very much resonates with that skit. Of all the people who show us love, there is no one who models Christ-like love better than a mother. Mothers are fiercely protective, soothing comforters, and they're self-sacrificing with their love. And I was going to tell a quick story of my own. It didn't involve a bear, but many of you know I'm a son of a lobsterman, but few of you know that I am the youngest of three boys. And my older two brothers are sort of sons of thunder types, hockey players, mean, tough, and just enjoy beating up on their little brother most of their life. Fortunately for me, I knew someone in town that was tougher than my two older brothers, and that was my mother. And so, and as the youngest son, I did have some favored status. And so whenever I was picked on by my older brothers, it was my mother who was my fierce defender. And so she just knew how to brush me off, kiss the wounds, a magic healing power of a mother's kiss. And she also comforted me when I was hurting. And not knowing we're going to show this video, when my heart had been injured and roughed up. And I'll never forget the heartache after my fifth grade girlfriend broke up with me, and I thought that life as I knew it was over. And it was my mom that soothed my broken heart and whispered to me that she never thought that much of my girlfriend anyway. Jesus' love for us is this kind of love. Jesus is our fierce defender. He is our staunchest advocate with the Father. And he's the one who heals our broken hearts, going as far as to send his own Holy Spirit to be our comforter. So our call to worship this morning gives a shout out to moms and praise to our great God. So please rise with me as we responsively do the call to worship. How happy is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. You will be blessed. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now dwells in you as well.
Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her.
Whatever is true, honorable, and just, whatever pure, lovely, and worthy of praise, think upon these things.
We come today to worship God, who promised us.
He is the one who loved us before we were yet born, knows us even better than we know ourselves, and watches over us with a love that never ceases. This is our great God. Let's worship him together. Amen.
Sing of your love forever. sing of your love forever. Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands, for I will always sing of when your love came down. I can sing of your love forever. 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 Oh, I feel like dancing. Of your love forever. I can sing 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 of your love forever.
This next song we're going to sing together and then do an around. You are my all in all. We're going to sing it straight through, first verse, the chorus, the second verse, and then the chorus all together. And then, after we've sung the whole thing, the men are going to sing verse one. You're still going to go in the same order. The men are going to start verse one again, and then the women are going to sing the chorus and sing verse two. So it's all together all the way through, verse, chorus. Then the men and the chorus, and then the women will do the chorus in verse two. If you get lost, just sing the chorus because it blends in with the whole thing.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel. Lord, to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name.
O Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory because of your love and your faithfulness. Amen. You may be seated. Well, happy Mother's Day, mothers. And it's a pleasure to have all of you here today. And we get the incredible privilege to dedicate this morning Eden and Adele. So why don't you guys come on up? Brown family will come on up, and why don't you guys, the girls, why don't you count them up right up here in front of Mom and Dad. Where is Evan? Is Evan here today? Come on up here. If Evan doesn't want to, I understand. That's but oh, that's right. He's with Pastor Chad. Evan is doing serious work, so he's good. Come on up here, Evan. See, that's the beauty of a family church. That's what family is all about. Well, Brian, I thought maybe it would be just appropriate for you to just introduce your entire family to everybody. And for some of us, we don't know the entire Brown family, and they also have family and friends here as well. So, Brian, why don't you go ahead and introduce all of your children to us?
All right, sounds good. Is the mic or just, I'll just talk loud.
Yeah.
I'm Brian. This is my wonderful wife, Bethany. And these are our children. There's Evan here, Carissa, Zoe, Lucia, Naomi, this is Eden, and Adiel.
And so aren't they just so cute? I mean, don't you just want to take a picture? Well, this morning we get to dedicate Eden and Adiel. And so while you guys hold Eden and Adiel, let me ask you a few questions. And we know that wherever you go, this is your heart's desire for your children, whatever church you attend. But we get the special privilege of sharing in these promises and in their commitment and helping them with their commitment. And so, Brian and Beth, will you do your best in the presence of God, your family and friends, to instill Eden and Adiel in the values and the teachings that will lead both of them to a personal saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ?
We will.
And will you make use of all the resources that God has given to you, your local church family, your friends, and your immediate family to help them grow in the love and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ?
We will.
And so to the church family, I ask you, will you help Brian and Beth, and will you come alongside of them so that Eden and Adiel would come to the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and help them grow in their faith together? Then I ask you to stand. Now, in light of their commitment to you today, I just want you to just step back, because I think it's cool to see the commitment that's behind you, the resources, the prayers, and we are just so excited for Eden and Adiel, but also for Brian and Beth and the entire family, for their brothers and sisters. So, I don't know who goes first. Who came out? I was going to say, who came out? All right. Eden?
You see Pastor Bob?
This is Eden.
That's Eden.
Yeah, I just want to make sure. Okay.
Oh, my goodness. You know how nerve-wracking it is for twins, you know? It's like, anyway. Well, Lord God in heaven, I pray for Eden, and I just ask you, God in heaven, that your hand of blessing will rest upon her. Lord Jesus, I ask you, dear God, that you'll help her come to a personal faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, to know you, love you, and serve you. In Christ's name, amen. All right. Eden, here you go. Here's Mom. And oh, no. Adiel, do you want to come over here?
See Pastor
Bob? Yay! Yay! Oh, hey, Adiel. Well, hey, Adiel, look at everybody. Hey, Adiel, let's pray. Well, God in heaven, I pray for Adiel. Her crying just represents a vibrant spirit that will be for you, and that you will use her in great ways as she comes to know you as her Lord and Savior, and that, Father, you'll use her to advance the kingdom of God. And we thank you in Christ's name. Amen. There you go. Do you guys have anything to say? Well, for Adiel and for Eden, we have a little Bible for each one of you. And I know that they will not remember this moment, but you will. And you can use that as a reminder of this moment in their lives, okay?
Thank you.
So, what does God's people say?
Amen.
Amen. I mean, we just say, Lord, put your hand upon them. And we're asking for his presence to be here and to be with them and to confirm these prayers. So we are very excited for you all. You're welcome. Now, kids, don't go too far because Pastor Chad has something for you now. So Pastor Chad, where's Pastor Chad? There he is.
Well, happy Mother's Day. Have some flowers up here for the ladies, and as much as I'd like to personally hand them out to all of you, I think I'm going to outsource the job. So all the kids, why don't you come up here? Awesome. Good crew. All right, normally these things are all about you guys, but today it's all about your mom. So, why don't you guys turn around and look at me for now. Now, in a moment, I'm going to ask you guys to pass out these flowers. And that's normally something we like to do on Mother's Day. We like to do things for our mothers. We like to give them things or do things for them. But sometimes, maybe we don't have money to spend on our moms. Maybe we don't have the ability to do things. But there's one thing we can always do for our moms, and that's pray for them. So, do you guys have any thing you can think of, any ways we could pray for our moms? You have any ideas? You don't have any? I guess Jessica's doing okay for herself. Anyone else? Anyone else have moms with maybe something? Help them? Like maybe give them strength to help as they raise you guys? They probably need a lot of it. Yeah. They won't get headaches when it's Mother's Day. Definitely. Anyone else? Any other ideas? Ways we could pray? Yeah.
Give your mom food.
For food? Give your mom food? Make sure they're provided for? Sure. Anyone else? I don't see many other light bulbs. So... Let's do this. Let's go ahead and pray for our moms right now, and then I'm going to ask you guys to hand out the flowers, okay? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for giving us our moms. Thank you for the families you've put us in. We're very thankful for the way you've created moms just to really show forth the love you have for us, which is unconditional. And so, Lord, we do pray for them, not just today, but for every day, Lord, as they deal with different things in life, their responsibilities to their children, that you would give them strength and that you provide for them every day. And Lord, just thank you again. Thank you for all the great moms you put in this church and the great role models they are for the rest of us. In your name I pray. Amen. All right, so now, guys, hold on. What I'm going to ask you guys to do is each take two flowers each. Now for the, all right, go ahead. Yeah, take the two flowers. Give one to your mom and give one to another lady in the church. Although Bethany is probably going to get more than most. Okay, and when you're done doing that, go ahead and come back up and grab another flower and find another lady that doesn't have one and give them out. Want to grab two? Go ahead and grab two. Raise your hand if you haven't gotten a flower yet. Or the kids find you a little easier. Okay, all the back row. Go ahead.
There's a saying that mothers are just like fathers, only more tired. And those of you who are moms are going, oh. There are times when you fall asleep the moment your head hits the pillow. There are other times you fall asleep while your head is on its way to hit the pillow. And then there are times that you just don't fall asleep because there's so much going on in your mind and you're so concerned for your family. You don't have to be a mom to have that feeling. And we have a very godly mom, and we are very grateful for our mother and all of the things that she did and the prayers and the sacrifices that she made so that we could be the women of God that we are. If you are a caregiver, if you are a dad, if you are an uncle, if you are a friend, this song is for you. We need to ask Jesus just to take the craziness of the day and the pain in our lives and all of the other things and just give it to him and let him take it, especially at night when the day has all been spent, and sometimes we still carry the day with us and we need to just give it up and to learn to rest in him.
Jesus, King of angels, heaven's light. Shine your face upon this house tonight. Let no evil come into my dreams. Light of heaven, keep me in your peace. Remind me how you made dark spirits flee and spoke your power to the raging sea. And spoke your mercy to a sinful man. Remind me, Jesus, for this is what I am. The universe is vast beyond the stars, but you are mindful. Find me, surround me, and
sovereign Lord. Tomorrow let me love you even more, and rise to speak the goodness of your name. Until I close my eyes in sleep again, the universe is vast beyond the stars, but you are mindful when the sparrow falls, and mindful thoughts that find me, surround me, and bind me. Jesus, King of angels, heaven's light, hold my hand and keep me through this night.
Thank you very much, ladies, and that was terrific. Well, we're going to dismiss the children. Is there Children's Church Day? Dismiss them for just a few minutes. It's so go ahead, kids. You can go ahead and be dismissed. And this morning, just like to give you a short challenge from God's Word before you guys head on off and you go do dinner or whatever you might do. My wife and I, we need to leave here and go do the concession stand at the Little League field. We'll have hot dogs and hamburgers or maybe, some onion rings or something like that. Well, I need to share with you just one mother joke, okay? Just it's Mother's Day. It's Sunday school. You know, our children learn a lot from Sunday school, don't they? You know, and so... At Sunday school, they were teaching how God created everything, including human beings. So little Johnny seems especially intent when they told him how Eve was created out of one of Adam's ribs. Later in the week, his mother noticed him lying down as though he were ill, and she said, "Johnny, what's the matter?" Little Johnny responded, "I have a pain in my side. I think I'm going to have a wife." Well, anyway, that's good. Well, let me ask you, who has influenced you? There are a lot of people out there who are ready to influence you, but who has influenced you? There are a number of theologians that have influenced you without even knowing it. A number of theologians have influenced your thinking about God. For example, there were the early Christian theologians. You know, people like Ignatius and Polycarp. Polycarp was one of the first martyrs of the church, and he was a defining point when he lost his life. It was a defining point for Christianity. Clement of Alexandria and St. Augustine. And St. Augustine, and many of you have heard about him, and St. Jerome, who wrote broadly and widely about the Catholic Church. Gregory the Great, who revised worship and wrote prolifically about worship and spirituality within the Catholic Church. Saint Francis of Assisi, and maybe some of you have heard of him. He was a well-known theologian who helped develop some of the doctrines of the Catholic Church as well, and not just the Catholic Church, but the Church. Saint Francis of Assisi was also known for preaching to the animals. But there's also the revivalists, the Reformed theologians. And the Reformed theologians, you know them, people like Martin Luther, who pinned the 95 Theses to the door of the church in Wittenberg, and John Calvin, a French reformist who broke with the Catholic Church and helped with the Protestant Reformation efforts, and wrote incredible amounts of doctrine, encouraging the church and thinking through theology and our relationship with God. And we understand things like predestination and developed what salvation is all about. And John Knox, who contributed to the Book of Prayer, and so many others. And so there were Reformed theologians as well, but there were also others, like more, if you want to look at the next ones, others who have changed our thinking, like Jonathan Edwards, who just wrote prolifically about philosophy and theology and helped us understand the relationship, the personal relationship between God and man, and was used widely for American revivals as God rose him up in his incredible preaching. And not only Jonathan Edwards, but Charles Wesley and John Wesley and George Whitefield and William Booth and so many others God used to help shape our thinking about who God is and how he works. And that's not to mention some of the more modern theologians as well, like Ravi Zacharias and John Stott and so many others that have contributed to our thinking on who God is and how he interacts with man. But this morning, I want you to think about somebody else who has influenced us as well. She was a mother. And God used her in an incredible way to shape our understanding of who this great God is and who we worship. She was not a college graduate. She was not prominent in her field of study. She was not rich. She was not middle class. As a matter of fact, she was trapped in a system where she felt as though she was invisible. She had no rights. She had no dignity. She had no freedom, nor did she have any choice. She is referred to as Abram and Sarah's maid. And you know who she is, Hagar. She was there to serve and to serve for a purpose. Her body was used to produce offspring to an infertile couple. And yet in her pain and in her struggles, God shows up through an angel. And so let's read this passage together. I know it's a sensitive passage on Mother's Day, but there's a few lessons that we can learn from the life of Hagar. Genesis chapter 16, verse 1. Now Sarah, Abram's wife, had borne him no children. But she had an Egyptian maidservant named Hagar. So she said to Abram, "The Lord has kept me from having children. Go, sleep with my maidservant. Perhaps I can build a family through her." Abram agreed to what Sarah said. So after Abram had been living in Canaan 10 years, Sarah, his wife, took her Egyptian maidservant, Hagar, and gave her to her husband to be his wife. He slept with Hagar, and she conceived. When she knew she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. Then Sarah said to Abram, "Are you responsible for the," she says, "you are responsible for the wrong I am suffering. I put my servant in your arms, and now that she knows she is pregnant, she despises me. May the Lord judge between you and me. Your servant is in your hands, Abram said. Do with her whatever you think best. Then Sarah mistreated Hagar, and so she fled from her. The angel of the Lord found Hagar near a spring in the desert. It was the spring that is beside the road to Shur. And he said, Hagar, servant of Sarah, where have you come from and where are you going? I am running away from my mistress, Sarah, she answered. Then the angel of the Lord told her, go back to your mistress and submit to her. The angel added, I will so increase your descendants that they will be too numerous to count. The angel of the Lord also said to her, you are now a child, and you will have a son. You shall name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard your misery. He will be a wild donkey of a man. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand against him. And he will live in hostility toward all his brothers. She gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her. You are the God who sees me. For she said, I have now seen the one who sees me. That is why the well will be called Bir Lehi Roi. It is still there between Kedesh and Bered. So why is Hagar so influential? Because she named God and it stuck. El Roi, the God who sees. The God who sees me. Few words, but incredible theology. That God could see me. In your goings forth and your goings out, the things you do, in the ordinary, God sees me. The one who sees. And from this account, we learn a few things. And let me just briefly share them with you. First, it's the Lord sees and he knows our struggles. He sees and he knows our struggles. You see, the Lord knew exactly what Hagar's troubles were. It's interesting because we have a question that's posed. The angel shows up, the angel of the Lord shows up and asks her a question. Where are you going? Now, what's interesting is simply this, is that the Lord knows what she's up to. It's no surprise to her. But sometimes I think the Lord wants us just to admit where we are. It says the angel of the Lord found Hagar near a spring in the desert. Verse 7. It was the spring that is beside the road of Shur, and he said, Hagar, servant of Sarah, where have you come from, and where are you going? Well, you know, in some respects, you think that's exactly what happens to people when they're running from the Lord. They don't know where they're going. They just know what they're running from. And in this case, Hagar, she doesn't have a clue. She doesn't know where she is going. All she knows is that she is running. You see, the Lord knew exactly what she was going through. Psalm 33, verses 13 through 15 says this: the Lord looks down from heaven. He sees all the sons of men. From his dwelling place, he looks out on the inhabitants of the earth. He who fashions the heart of them, he understands all their works. You see, this God looks down from heaven and he understands man. You see, we think we're the one who's looking, and yet God is the one who is really seeing. I've had the incredible privilege of taking four teams to Kenya. And one of the favorite activities, which maybe by God's grace I'll be able to take my wife and my children there to do the same thing, is to go out and look for baboons. There's just, you know, just something fun about it. Now, you walk down this road and you're looking. Can you imagine playing softball with baboons in the trees? This, Jim, you know. Well, you know, anyway, so you go down this road and you're looking up and you're looking up and you're saying, well, no baboons today. You know, these trees are really, really, really high. I mean, really high. But little do you know that they see you all the time. They got a fix on you, and they're probably sitting up in those trees saying, look at those guys. Look at those animals. Crazy. What are they looking at? Huh. And so we are like, I wasn't going to say, God is like the baboon, no. But God is up there, and he sees. And he sees, and he understands. He understands our struggles, and he understood Hagar's struggles as well. Now, guys, I want you to know this. This is a bonus for you, okay? The Lord understands Abram's struggles here too, because he is in a no-win situation, is he not? Should I say, guys, can anybody relate to that? Don't answer that. He is in a no-win situation. He is told to take my servant Hagar, take her as your wife. He does, she conceives, and then he's in trouble. And so, just my simple point here is that the Lord completely understands your struggles. He understood Hagar's struggles. He understood Sarah's struggles. And he understood Abram's struggles as well. But in the middle of seeing, he also corrects. The Lord sees and corrects us. You know, he doesn't just let us wander. Sometimes he needs to speak into our lives, and he needs to correct us. And in verse 9, well, let me back up. Verse 7, it says, the angel of the Lord found Hagar near a spring in the desert. It was the spring that is beside the road to Shur. And he said, Hagar, servant of the Lord, where have you come from? Where are you going? I am running away from my mistress, Sarah, she answered. Then the angel of the Lord told her, go back to your mistress and submit to her. Now, I find this interesting because the Lord sees what's going on, and guess what? I really believe Sarah was mistreating her. We could interpret this a number of different ways, but Sarah was mistreating her. It's not what we expect from Sarah, but she was being mistreated. As a matter of fact, there was probably animosity between both of them, and it obviously grew to a boiling point. Now she is sitting in the desert, and she's running away, and she says to the angel of the Lord that my master or Sarah is mistreating me. Now the Lord, or the angel of the Lord, doesn't say, oh, I understand. That's okay. You're justified in running away. No. In this case, the angel of the Lord said, go back. Now why? Was it because Sarah's mistreatment wasn't that bad? The passage is silent. We don't know. We don't know why, but one suspicion I have is simply this. She had to go back because Hagar was taking life into her own hands. She was doing it her way. And God says, you can't do it your way. You got to do it my way. And so he sends her back. We don't even know if Abraham and Sarah missed Hagar. We don't even know it. But if they did, can you imagine the conversation that Hagar and Sarah must have had? Can you imagine the humble pie that Hagar had to eat to go back into that situation? You see, Hagar humbly submitted to the will of the Lord. And it tells us something a little about Hagar. She had a teachable spirit before him. Do you have a teachable spirit before the Lord? You know, we often think of Ishmael as the bad guy, and in some respects he's prophesied to be like that, his hands against his brothers, and we understand the historical significance of that. I won't get into that right now, but just think about Hagar, because Hagar was just doing what she was told. And so she had a humble spirit to submit to the Lord's guidance to go back to Sarah. You see, in the middle of God's discipline, you need to know that he loves you. 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, the eyes of the Lord move to and fro throughout the earth. And why? To get back at them? To not bless them? He does so to strengthen his people, so that he may strongly support those whose heart is completely his. And so here we have the angel of the Lord moving to and fro throughout the earth, so that he may come along and give strength to those whose heart are completely his. I would encourage you to go home today and read out of Hebrews chapter 4 and Hebrews 12 verse 4 and following. But let me just read just a small portion of 5 and 6. In Hebrews, the writer wrote, do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines those he loves. He punishes everyone he accepts as sons. Our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good, that we may share in his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. But later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. And so the Lord sees and he corrects. But lastly, I want you to see that the Lord sees and he comforts. Then the angel of the Lord, verse 9, told her, go back to your mistress and submit to her. The angel added, I will so increase your descendants that they will be too numerous to count. The angel of the Lord also said to her, you are now with child, and you will have a son. You shall name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard your misery. He will be a wild donkey of a man. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand against him, and he will live in hostility toward all his brothers. Now, you see, I want you to focus in on that one verse. For the Lord has heard your misery, or he has heard your prayers, or he has seen and he has heard your struggles. You see, it's the Lord's desire to come alongside those who are hurting, and that's exactly what he does here. He hears her misery. There are a lot of Hagars out there, a lot. They have been mistreated. They have been hurt. They have been abused. And God hears their misery. Turn to Exodus chapter 3, verse 7. Here we have God, and he's speaking to Moses in the bush. And now Moses is standing at the bush. God says, don't come any closer. Take off your sandals. And in verse 7, it says this. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So does God stand around and do nothing? No. He sends a deliverer. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, to bring them up to that land, into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. You see, God sees, and he brings comfort. Isaiah. Turn to Isaiah for a moment. Isaiah 57, 15. Isaiah 57. It says this. And maybe to capture the context, verse 13 says, and when you cry out for help, God is disciplining his people. And it says, when you cry out for help, let your collection of idols save you. The wind will carry all of them off. A mere breath will blow them away. But the man who makes me his refuge will inherit the land and possess my holy mountain. And it will be said, build up, prepare the road, remove the obstacles out of the way of my people. For this is what the high and lofty one says, he who lives forever, whose name is holy, I live in high places and holy place, but also with him who is contrite and lowly in spirit, to revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. I will not accuse forever, nor will I always be angry. For then the spirit of man will grow faint before me, the breath of man that I have created. I was enraged by his sinful greed. I punished him. I hid my face in anger. He kept on in his willful ways. I have seen his ways, but I will heal him. I will guide him, and I will restore him, creating praise on the lips of the mourners in Israel. And see, God's heart's desire is to comfort his people. And so even in Hagar's misery, God comes to her and he comforts her. And my friends, he sees, and ladies and mothers, he sees your sacrifice. In the middle of your struggles, the Lord will comfort you because he sees your sacrifice. He will not reject you. nor like he did not even, he did not reject Hagar, he will not reject you. Because he loves you, he cares for you, and he watches over you. I am reminded of a mother. Can you just picture this, a mom? And you know, have you ever felt like this, mom or even dads? Your kid is in the high chair, and you know, they take the Cheerios and they throw it, and then they take the bottle, man, and just throw it across the room. Moms, you ever feel like that? You want to throw that sippy cup across the room? Come on, moms. Yeah, I'm sure you've been there. If you're honest, you've been there. Well, I just want to encourage you and to let you know that God sees, and he sees your struggles. He sees, and he'll even correct your attitude if it needs to be adjusted. And he sees, and he comforts you. And this is the great God we serve. And that's how Hagar has influenced us, because she realized that this great God, the one that we worship, is the one who sees. Let me pray. Well, Father, thank you for your word and how short we didn't spend a lot of time in it today. But God in heaven, I pray that you will speak to us and you will remind us of your great love and your comfort. In Christ's name, amen. Join us for this closing song as we consider God's great love.
Be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Well, mothers, we hope you have a great Mother's Day, and we hope that the Lord will just be with you. Paul wrote to the Ephesians in the closing of his letter, he says, "Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love." And so that's our prayer for you, mothers, that you will experience God's grace with an undying love. And all of God's people said, amen. Before you leave, I want to invite you. I know you probably have dinner and everything else, but the children have cheese and crackers for all the ladies here at the church. So waiters, you may come in. And as we are dismissed, there's cheese and crackers and things like that waiting for you. So, okay? Blessings.